Hello, welcome back. I'm Dr. Dilip from Bali Rameshwar's IAS Academy. As usual, we'll be discussing the current affairs from the Hindu newspaper. Today's date, 29th April. To begin with, the first article talks about Ministry does U-turn on plasma therapy. The Union Health Ministry said on Tuesday that plasma therapy is not an approved treatment for COVID-19 and is only one of the several therapies being explored currently. The therapy is still at an experimental stage and the Indian Council of Medical Research is currently studying its efficacy. ICMR has not given any clearance for its use as prescribed treatment, and misuse can have fatal outcomes for the patients, the ministry said. The Health Ministry's statement comes days after the Drug Controller General of India gave its go-ahead to a proposal by ICMR for a clinical trial of convalescent plasma therapy in COVID-19 patients as per the protocol developed by the council. So what is this convalescent plasma therapy? As we have already discussed in the earlier current affair videos, once again going through it, it is an experimental procedure for COVID-19 patients. In this treatment, plasma from a COVID-19 patient who has recovered from the disease is transfused into a coronavirus patient who is in critical condition. And the idea behind this therapy is that immunity can be transferred from a healthy person to a sick patient using convalescent plasma. This therapy uses antibodies from the blood of a recovered coronavirus patient to treat another critical patient. The recovered COVID-19 patient's blood develops antibodies to battle against COVID-19. Once the blood of the first patient is infused to the second patient, those antibodies will start fighting against coronavirus in the second person. So this plasma therapy was discovered by German physiologist Emil von Behring, and plasma therapy was first used in 1890. In 2014, the World Health Organization has recommended that plasma therapy to treat Ebola virus disease. And plasma therapy was also used earlier during the Spanish flu pandemic and during H1N1, that is swine flu infection of 2019. And China, where the coronavirus outbreak first emerged, had used this treatment to treat critical COVID-19 patients. Two trials of plasma therapy was conducted on 15 coronavirus patients and they showed improvement. At this moment, the ICMR does not recommend this as a treatment option outside clinical trials. So there may be misconception among individuals or the public that plasma, that is convalescent plasma therapy, is the treatment modality for COVID-19. But to do away with that, and as there is no evidence right now to support that this is the treatment modality for COVID-19, the Union Health Ministry has given a directive that this plasma therapy is not the treatment of choice, but rather it is a trial treatment that can be done, a trial therapy that can be carried out in salvaging the critically ill individuals once this convalescent plasma therapy is carried out. And at cases, this convalescent plasma therapy, if not performed in a proper way, can be deadly. That is, the plasma, that is a liquid component of the blood, which constitutes about 55% of the blood, will also carry different types of antibodies and substances. And these, sometimes when injected into individuals, can lead to allergic reactions which may be life-threatening. Then moving on to the next topic. Government starts planning for Haridwar Kumbh Mela. So what is this Haridwar Kumbh Mela? To understand, we will go back about the legend. That the legend has it that in the mythological times, during a waging war between demigods and demons, for the possession of elixir of eternal life, a few drops of it had fallen on four places that are today known as Prayag, Haridwar, Ujjain and Nasik. It is believed that these drops have given mystical powers to these places. It is to make oneself gain on those powers that Kumbh Mela has been celebrated in each of the four places since long as one can remember. The normal Kumbh Mela is held every 3 years. The Arth Kumbh Mela or Half Kumbh Mela is held every 6 years at Haridwar and Allahabad, while the Purn or Complete Kumbh Mela takes place every 12 years at four places: Prayag, Haridwar, Ujjain, Nasik. And if you see here the article, it talks about the Mahakumbh Mela in Uttarakhand state, that is in Haridwar. So this Mahakumbh Mela, which is organized once in 12 years, was previously launched or held in 2010, when about 10 million people have been reportedly congregated. So right now in 2021 January, again this Kumbh Mela is going to be organized. So the government, that is the, especially the National Mission for Clean Ganga under the Water Ministry, has discussed the funds needed for the Uttarakhand government for providing community toilets and urinals for the attendees. And we have to still see that whether such mass gathering, that is large gatherings, can be allowed in a significant short period of time, that is by January 2021. And what is this National Mission for Clean Ganga? It is the implementation wing of the National Council for Rejuvenation, Protection and Management of River Ganga, also known as National Ganga Council. So now it is renamed as National Ganga Council, and it was established in the year 2011 as a registered society. It has a two-tier management structure and comprises of Governing Council and Executive Committee. The aims and objectives of National Mission for Clean Ganga include to ensure effective control of pollution and rejuvenation of the River Ganga by adopting a river basin approach, to promote intersectoral coordination for comprehensive planning and management, and to maintain minimum ecological flow in the River Ganga with the aim to ensure water quality and environmentally sustainable development. So initially, if you see, the National Mission for Clean Ganga was under the Ministry of Environment and Forests, and then later it was moved under the Ministry of Water Resources during the Modi government's first stint. Then a new Jal Shakti Ministry was established, in which the erstwhile Ministries of Water Resources and Drinking Water and Sanitation will be merged and has been formed with Gajendra Singh Shekhawat at its helm. So now the National Mission for Clean Ganga under the Namami Gange program is present under the Jal Shakti Ministry. And moving on to the next topic, vividly imagining life of migrant workers. So this article is about a regime of social policy must be installed to meet the basic needs of all citizens at all times and not only during pandemics. So this article talks about the role of migrant workers in Indian economy. So if migrant workers are not present, then the economy will be significantly affected, because these migrant workers are the cogs, are the functionaries which help in leading the economy. That is, they work in a lot of industries, thereby which adding up to the economy. If the migrant workers are affected and they are not effectively participating in the production process, it will negatively affect the economy. And about the definition of home. So home is not made of brick and mortar, and certainly not of tin and wood. It is where one finds comfort, nurtures relationships, and raises a family. So even if the migrant workers are given all the amenities in this period of time where lockdown is in place, they will not be interested to stay at the place of work, but they will be interested to move to their place of residence, that is home, so that they can have proper relations or they can have sufficient time with the family. And the next one comes, differential treatment meted out by Indians, that is migrants abroad and migrants within the country. So if at all you see the beginning of lockdown or the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic, initially a lot of migrant workers or NRIs who were present outside the country were allowed to enter the country, and thereby which spreading the pandemic from those individuals to many individuals of the country. But the government has all of a sudden has imposed an unplanned lockdown, thereby which affecting the lives of many migrants within the country, preventing their movement from their place of work to the place of residence. So why this differential treatment and why that favorism towards the NRIs or the migrants who are abroad when compared with the migrants within the country, and non-payment or delayed payments of wages to migrant workers? So seeing the condition of migrant workers in the present scenario, if at all we compare the lifestyle or the condition of migrant workers in the country before the pandemic or before the onset of pandemic, still they were plagued with the non-payment or delayed payments of wages because their job opportunities or their employment opportunities were not guaranteed, and they had to rely on the whims and fancies of, or they were at the disposal of the management and the concept of welfare state. So the welfare of the migrant workers in this lockdown period has been given more emphasis by the government of India by it doling out the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. But this welfare state idea should be relevant even after the pandemic ceases. And the MGNREGA scheme, that is Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act scheme, which allows the manual labor of the individuals who are poverty stricken and provides for a compulsory employment opportunities to these individuals at times needed. And in this present pandemic time, where MGNREGA is going to help these individuals to earn certain money, certain amount of money by which their livelihood chances increases. But this includes strenuous physical activity, which is very hard. And this article also talks about stop viewing poor as subhuman and the need of social policies. The policymakers most of the time tend to visualize the poor as subhuman. That is said because they always think about the basic needs of the poor, that is the food and the shelter. And if not, the poor are seen as that they just reproduce and give rise to more population. But the needs of the poor are not taken into consideration as that of a normal human. That is the need of quality time with children, leisure for themselves, companionship, friendship, a flourishing social life, music, literature, art, poetry, and so on. Where these are enjoyed by the rich, but are denied, but are not enjoyed by the poor. So this article talks about that the policy makers should feel the pain of the poor while they are making the policy so that it will benefit the poor in a larger way. Then moving on to the next topic, signaling support. So this article is about the RBI's recent move in extending loans or in extending the funds to the banks under a repo rate, which is roughly about 50,000 crore, which can be used by the commercial banks to lend to the mutual funds or the debt market. So you can see that recent winding of the mutual funds, that is six mutual funds by Franklin Templeton, citing illiquid conditions, that is lack of liquidity in the market. So RBI has immediately stepped in order to prevent the further spread of the problem of liquidity crisis, thereby which trying to infuse about 50,000 crore into the mutual fund market by carrying out activity that is similar to the targeted long-term repo operations which have been done in case of the NBFCs. But here we have to wait and see if the banks will be ready to take in the loans at a 90-day tenure from the RBI and be ready to extend them to the mutual fund market, whereby which they are significantly increasing their risk. And here RBI has said something that is called as the 25% ceiling on held to maturity investments. So here the restriction is that the held to maturity investment should not breach the 25% ceiling mark set by the RBI unless and until certain provisions or certain conditions are met. Now, will the banks be ready to breach this 25% held to maturity? That is when they are holding, when they are extending loans to the mutual funds market, then they are going to take back the amount once the maturity of that fund is realized. So we have to wait and see, though the center is ready to step in the right direction, but will the banks be ready to follow the same or do the same by taking up risks? Moving to the next topic, outline of another pandemic combat strategy. So once India has tasted the pandemic, we should be ready to outline and combat strategy if at all another pandemic is coming onto the way. And this article talks about few things, that is the benefit of lockdown. And here, lockdown has been imposed in India in order to restrict the rise of number of cases of COVID-19. But what is the actual purpose of the lockdown? The actual purpose of lockdown is to gain certain time or to buy in certain time so that in this period, the vaccine or the treatment modalities of COVID-19 can be invented and they can be utilized. But that has not been done. So what next? Should the lockdown be extended? It is said that by extending lockdown, there is no use and it will affect the economy in a negative way. And this article also talks about the estimates of COVID-19 cases in India given by epidemiologists, which is unlikely when compared with that of the data given by the government. So two epidemiologists who speak about citing that once the lockdown has been lifted up, you can really see the number of cases, because about 80% of the cases that have been diagnosed as COVID-19 have appeared to be asymptomatic. So there could be a lot of asymptomatic cases in the country. So one epidemiologist states that the total number of infections could be around 2,50,000, while another epidemiologist talks about that there would be 60 people who have not been counted for every one case that is recorded. Then next thing is measures to be taken till vaccine is made available. So you cannot continue lockdown as long as the vaccine is not available. So there should be some measures by which easing of lockdown should be done. And how can that be done? That can be achieved by allowing individuals who are less susceptible to the COVID-19 in a proper way and restricting the people who are more susceptible to COVID-19. So the young individuals who are relatively immune or not susceptible to COVID-19 can be allowed to move by following the proper norms of social distancing and hand hygiene and respiratory hygiene, thereby which the economy of the country can be brought back onto the rails. Then this article also talks about the concept of reverse quarantine. That is, the old people and the people with comorbidities should self-isolate themselves, which is called as reverse quarantine. Then herd immunity. So herd immunity is a concept when the disease spreads naturally, infecting a significant population, thereby which when the significant population is recovered, it is immune to the disease. And the concept of herd immunity has been seen that an option to face the problem of COVID-19, as a significant time has lapsed without the invention or creation of a vaccine for COVID-19. But if we think that we have to rely on the herd immunity, there is a significant population which is vulnerable to COVID-19, that is the old age people and the people with comorbidities. So we cannot wait for the herd immunity to come up by which putting an end to the disease. And this article also talks about the chances of reinfection. So WHO has noted that there is no clear-cut understanding regarding whether the individuals who have been recovered from COVID-19 post-infection and once they are recovered, are they immune to be reinfected? There are incidences, there are cases where individuals have been shown to be tested positive even after they have earlier tested negative and have been declared free of COVID-19. Then moving on to the next topic, privacy concerns during a pandemic. Government's technology solutions to find COVID-19 do not meet minimum legal requirements. So this article talks about the government using excuse of catastrophe to ignore rule of law. And it says the rule of law should never be ignored, no matter what. And the chances of overreach by the government of India are more in place, which will tend to be as the new normal that is set in the post-COVID-19 scenario. So the government, by its strict implementation or ever-changing rules which do not comply with the rule of law, and these are being forced on the people, and the only excuse that it is citing is, as we are right now in the pandemic and lives are needed to be saved, all these measures have to be followed strictly despite they are spelling a negative impact on the lives of many individuals. The using of people's personal data, that is in apps like Arogya Setu. And this article also talks about the use of technology at three levels. And the three levels are, firstly, creating list of suspected to be infected with COVID-19. And once this list has been created, they follow the second thing that is called deploying geofencing and drones in order to monitor the home quarantined individuals, and also using the contract tracing smartphone applications like Arogya Setu. So if you see one by one, the creating list of suspected to be infected with COVID-19 is necessary. You can't deny it. But once if some name comes or is present in the list without actually being, then the individual will be affected. And coming to the second thing, so government is deploying geofencing and drones where drones are not legalized. And many drones that are used are not even registered with the Ministry of Home Affairs. And this is an illegal way. And the third thing is using contact tracing smartphone applications where the data of the individuals who are registered is in Jeopardy. There is no security that is provided as similarity of Arogya Setu to Aadhaar. We don't know what is happening to the data. Government is making it mandatory. So actually when the Aadhaar Act or Aadhaar Bill was presented in the parliament, it is said that Aadhaar is not mandatory but is voluntary. And over a period of time, you can see that Aadhaar was made mandatory for many of the services provided by the government. In a similar way here, citing that we are in a catastrophe and ignoring the rule of law, the government is trying to impose the Arogya Setu app on every individual and is making it mandatory. This Arogya Setu app is only available on the smartphones, but not available on dumb phones or the feature phones. Most number of people hold feature phones, that is especially the poorer masses. So here the government is impacting the poorer or discriminating against the poorer masses, by which the app is not developed in order to favor these poorer masses. And here especially whenever we talk about the data, we have to talk about the data privacy. And the Supreme Court in its judgment regarding the Kumaraswamy versus Union of India has declared that the right to privacy is a fundamental right. But still being a fundamental right, there are provisions for the central government where the privacy breach can occur. But it has to be done only if the benefits outweigh the risks or damages. But here, do you think or does the government think that these benefits by using this Arogya Setu app will outweigh the damages of privacy? And this Arogya Setu app works on the inputs that an individual gives to the app. So if at all the data that is fed into the app by the individual is genuine, then only we can help in thinking that this app will be instrumental in trying to prevent the contact of healthy individuals with the affected individuals. But what if the data that is fed into the system or the application is falsy or faulty? Then the entire working of the Arogya Setu app is in a questionable state. And moving on to the next thing, unlocking justice in the lockdown. So this article talks about abiding by the constitution. So no matter what a pandemic is, all the things that are done by the government should always abide by the rules and regulations laid down in the constitution. And also this article talks about the non-inclusion of lawyers and judiciary as essential service. And without legal practitioners being classified as essential, fundamental rights cannot be realized. So it is the judiciary that will safeguard the fundamental rights of the citizens. When the government is making a lot of regulations and putting a lot of restrictions on the individuals, where at certain times the fundamental rights can be violated, if at all the judiciary or the lawyers or the legal practitioners are not classified as essentials, who will be there in order to defend or to protect the fundamental rights of the citizens of the country and the high-handedness of the police on the common man? So there are instances where the police are being high-handed, that is thrashing a lot of innocent people, that is the migrant workers who are on a flight to move from their place of work to the place of residence. And there are instances where still, despite the lockdown in place, few individuals have been arrested, citing their active participation in the anti-citizenship protests. And justice being inaccessible, and because the codes are not in function, only the virtual codes are in functionality. So it is difficult for the poor to have access to justice as they cannot be using the virtual courts. And rise in domestic violence and lack of legal remedies. With lockdown in place, there has been reports of increased domestic violence cases against women all through the globe. And the same is the condition in India. But how can these women get the legal remedies when the legal practitioners are not classified as essential? And justice must not become a casualty of the pandemic. And moving to the next topic, Congress questions government over 68,607 crore loan write-off. So the Congress on Tuesday asked Prime Minister Narendra Modi to explain why this government had written off bank loan worth 68,607 crore taken by top 50 defaulters, including Nirav Modi, Mehul Chowski, and Vijay Mallya, at a time when the country is fighting the coronavirus pandemic. So what is meant by write-off? It is not as same as wave off. We have to understand that. So writing off a toxic loan does not mean the loan has been forgiven. It means that the bank has made 100% provisioning, that is setting aside capital against the loan to protect depositors even if not a paisa of that loan is repaid. Banks use write-offs to remove bad loans from their balance sheet and minimize their tax liability. So in the balance sheet, what happens is they have to show their assets and liabilities, and loans are nothing but assets to the banks. And whatever that interest that the banks are going to earn on that loans are also reflected in the balance sheet. Even if the asset, that is the loan, turning into a non-performing asset or a bad loan, or the banks are liable to be taxed for the interest that they are going to get on that loan. But actually, the loans are not getting any interest payments. So it will be a loss to the bank. And at the same time, the more number of bad loans will start appearing on the balance sheets, which will significantly decrease the credibility of the banks. So to overcome this, what happens is the banks have decided to write off the bad loans, that is removing the bad loans from their balance sheet, that is not showing them. But the capital has to be present in order to accommodate for the capital equivalent to that of bad loans. So the bank have provisioned by putting the capital whatever the bad loans are equivalent to, and the banks are going to continue pursuing regarding the repayment of the toxic loans that have been defaulted. The amount that bank has written off will not be counted as part of its gross and net non-performing assets. However, the borrower will not be exempted or pardoned from debt repayments, as the bank will not halt recovery. So banks do not lose interest in the written off asset and may recover their loan in part when a bad loan reaches resolution. When a value is realized, the provisions are written back. A write back goes into the profit and loss account of the bank and boosts the bank's bottom line. A recent example of such write back or write off by SBI is the SR Steel resolution. Moving on to the next topic. Niti Aayog slams India's terror ranking. So India has been recently ranked as the 7th worst terrorism affected country in the world. So this ranking has been given by the Institute for Economic and Peace, which publishes the Global Terrorism Index. Global Terrorism Index is a report published annually by the Institute of Economic and Peace. It is an attempt to systematically rank the nations of the world according to terrorist activity. The index combines number of factors associated with the terrorist attacks to build an explicit picture of the impact of terrorism, illustrating trends and providing a data series for analysis by researchers and policy makers. So here, taking into consideration number of incidents of terrorism, number of deaths related to terrorism, number of people injured because of terrorism, all these incidents are taken into consideration and the index is formulated, which will show that how annually the countries are affected by terrorism. So the Global Terrorism Index covers about 163 countries, almost covering 99.7% of world population. And the recent ranking given by Institute for Economics and Peace in its Global Terrorism Index rates India as the 7th worst terrorism affected country ahead of the conflict-ridden countries such as Democratic Republic of Congo, South Sudan, Sudan, Burkina Faso, Palestine, and Lebanon. So the report that is given by Niti Aayog, what it does is it questions the opaque funding of Institute for Economics and Peace. This report is having a negative impact on the economy of the country by having a threat to the investments that are coming into the country. So the people who want to invest in the country are afraid because of the worst rating provided by the Institute for Economics and Peace through its Global Terrorism Index. Niti Aayog has questioned in a report about the methodology adopted by this Australian-based institute to rank India. Then moving to the next topic. Anti-graft law covers deemed university. What is meant by graft? Anti-graft. So if you see, graft is a form of political corruption. So anti-graft means anti-corruption law covers deemed universities. So what are deemed universities? Deemed university or deemed to be university is an accreditation awarded to higher educational institutions in India, conferring the status of a university. It is granted by Department of Higher Education. So, in a significant ruling, Supreme Court has held that bribery and corruption in a deemed university can be tried under the Prevention of Corruption Act. And it cited that individuals, authorities, or officials connected to the deemed university, whatever be their role or designation, come under the definition of public servant. And thus, they can be tried and punished under the anti-corruption law, the court said. The deemed universities come within the ambit of the term university in section 2 clause c clause 11 of the Prevention of Corruption Act 1988. So if you see the Prevention of Corruption Act section 2 clause c clause 11 of the 1998 Act, the public servant means any person who is a vice chancellor or a member of any governing body, professor, lecturer, or any other teacher or employee by whatever designation called of any university and any person whose services have been availed by the university or any other public authority in connection with holding or conducting examinations. Then moving on to the next thing.
The US Commission on International Religious Freedom
downgrades India in 2020 list. So citing recent religious struggle that is happening in the country, that is India has been facing a lot of criticism regarding the Citizenship Amendment Act and the ongoing National Register for Citizens and anti-conversion laws and situation in Jammu and Kashmir. All this have significantly affected the rating or the position, and it has downgraded India to the lowest ranking, that is countries of particular concern, in its 2020 report. But the government of India has rubbished because it has been placed alongside countries including China, North Korea, Saudi Arabia, and Pakistan, where religious freedom is not existent. If you see, in 2005, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who was the then Chief Minister of Gujarat, was censured by USCIRF. The commission has recommended sanctions against Mr. Modi for the 2002 riots, and the US government has subsequently cancelled his visa. And here, the USCIRF 2020 report, it makes a specific mention of the Home Minister Amit Shah for not taking what is deemed as sufficient action to stop case of mob lynching in the country. Then moving on to the next thing. The center starts preparing for post-lockdown urban services. Urban Affairs Ministry to ready protocols for metro trains and missions. So the officials of Union Housing and Urban Affairs Ministry were on Tuesday asked to start preparing the post-lockdown protocols for various urban missions and services, including operation of metro trains. Ministry of State for Housing and Urban Affairs, Hardeep Singh Puri, reviewed the progress of the various urban missions, including the Smart Cities Mission, the Swachh Bharat Mission, and Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban being implemented by the ministry. So here only what that is important in this article is we coming to understand about what this Swachh Bharat Mission is, what is the Smart Cities Mission, what is Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, and what is Atal Mission for Rejuvenation and Urban Transformation, that is AMRUT. To begin with, Swachh Bharat Mission, as you know, that it is also called as Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, which was previously named as Nirmal Bharat Abhiyan, and it is also called as Clean India Mission. It was the country-wide campaign from 2014 to 2019 to eliminate open defecation and improve solid waste management in urban and rural areas. The objectives of the mission also included to eradicate manual scavenging, generating awareness and bringing about behavioral change regarding sanitation process or practices and augmentation of capacity at local level initiated by the government of India. And the mission is aimed to achieve an open defecation free India by 2nd October 2019, the 150th anniversary of the birth of Mahatma Gandhi. So the government claims that Swachh Bharat mission has been 100% successful, but the reports state otherwise. Then coming to the second thing, the Smart Cities Mission. So the Smart Cities Mission is an innovative and new initiative by the government of India to drive economic growth and improve the quality of life of people by enabling local development and harnessing technology as a means to create smart outcomes for citizens. So smart cities focus on their most pressing needs and on greatest opportunities to improve lives. They tap on range of approaches including digital and information technologies, urban planning best practices, public-private partnerships and policy change to make a difference, and they always put people first. Then moving on to the next thing, the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban Mission. So it is a mission which was launched in 2015, which intends to provide housing for all in urban areas by the year
2022.
The mission provides central assistance to the implementing agencies through states and union territories and central nodal agencies for providing houses to all eligible families beneficiaries against the validated demand for houses for about 1.12 crore as per Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban Guidelines. The size of house for economically weaker sections could be up to 30 square meters carpet area. However, the states or union territories have the flexibility to enhance the size of houses in consultation and approval of the ministry. Then Atal Mission for Rejuvenation and Urban Transformation, which is also called Amrut. It was launched in the year 2015 with the focus to establish infrastructure that could ensure adequate robust sewage networks and water supply for urban transformation by implementing urban revival projects. So Rajasthan was the first state in the country to submit state annual action plan under Atal Mission for Rejuvenation and Urban Transformation. And moving on to the next topic, massive evacuation planned from Gulf. So with the ongoing pandemic of COVID-19 and a lot of Indian diaspora who are stranded in the Gulf countries, and many have lost their jobs and they are not in a proper condition to live over there. So they have asked the Indian government that they should provide proper transport measures and allow the movement of these people from the Gulf countries back into India. And for this, the Indian government is readying up naval ships and Indian Air Force or Air India planes so that they can carry out the evacuation process. The Union government is drawing up a major evacuation plan involving Navy, Indian Air Force and Air India to bring back Indian stranded in West Asia following the nationwide lockdown and travel restrictions due to COVID-19. So if you see the previous evacuation operations by Indian Air Force and Indian Navy, they include Operation Rahat, that is done during the Yemen crisis, that is the Yemen civil war between the Houthi rebels and the Saudi Arabia led coalition. So Indians and other foreigners were airlifted under Operation Rahat. And second thing is Operation Sankat Mochan, where the Indian citizens and foreigners were evacuated from South Sudan during the South Sudanese civil war. And the 1990 airlift of Indians from Kuwait during the Kuwait invasion, and Operation Homecoming during the Libyan civil war, and Operation Sukoon in 2006 during the Lebanon war. These were the previous incidents where humanitarian and disaster relief efforts were carried out by the Indian Navy and Indian Air Force under the guidance of Government of India. So now, because the Government of India, that is Indian Air Force, has a fleet of US origin C-130 Hercules medium transporters and C-17 Globemaster heavy transport aircraft, in addition to the old Russian IL-76 aircraft, they are playing a significant role in such evacuation programs. Then moving on to the next topic, the midday meals on during vacation. So center is going to provide aid of about 958 crore to the respective state governments so that they can carry out the midday meal scheme. So what is midday meal scheme? It is to enhance the enrollment, retention and attendance and simultaneously improve nutrition levels among school going children during their study of classes 1 to 8 of the government and government aided school, special training centers and madrasas and maktabs, which are both Islamic institutions which are supported under Sarva Siksha Abhiyan. The midday meal scheme in India has a long history dating back to 1925, where it was first started by the Madras Municipal Corporation in Tamil Nadu. Later, it was extended to many states including Gujarat, Kerala, Tamil Nadu and the Union Territory of Pondicherry by 1980s. And by 1990-1991, this program has been implemented on a large scale and increased to 12 states. And the scheme guidelines, which envisage to provide cooked midday meal with 450 calories and 12 grams of protein to every child at primary level and 700 calories and 20 grams of protein at upper primary level. So this energy and protein requirement for a primary child comes from cooking 100 grams of rice or flour, 20 grams of pulses, 50 grams of vegetables and 5 grams of oil. And for a child of upper primary school, 150 grams of rice or flour, 30 grams of pulses, 75 grams of vegetables and 7.5 grams of oil. So this midday meal scheme is very important in order to continue the survival of the poverty-stricken people, that is especially the students or children from the poorer masses. So the central government has released a corpus fund of 958 crores, which will be used to continue the purchase and supply of essentials, that is pulses, vegetable oil and spices and fuel, by hiking their annual allocation so that they can continue the midday meal scheme. So several reports states that Kerala is providing actual cooked meals delivered to the homes of poor students, and a large number of other states including Karnataka and West Bengal are providing dry rations to students' families in lieu of cooked meals during the lockdown. And the Delhi schools do not see any of the offering, that is neither cooked meal or the dry rations being given. So a lot of people are suffering with hunger and malnutrition. In order to meet their needs, the central government has decided to extend the scheme. And no improvement in Ganga water quality during lockdown. So the lockdown may have dramatically reduced air pollution across the country, but it hasn't significantly reduced pollution in Ganga, according to a report by the Central Pollution Control Board. So what the Central Pollution Control Board states is the dissolved oxygen concentration, which is a measure of the amount of free oxygen available in the river systems, rose marginally. So what is meant by dissolved oxygen? So dissolved oxygen is nothing but the amount of oxygen that is dissolved in the water. So for the organisms in the water to survive, they also need oxygen and they depend upon dissolved oxygen. The dissolution of oxygen in water is increased by the presence of sunlight. But despite of the lockdown in place, contrary to those expectations, the dissolved oxygen concentration has only risen marginally. And the two other measures, that is biological oxygen demand and chemical oxygen demand, both the indicators of amount of oxygen necessary to break organic and inorganic pollution, showed insignificant reductions. So what is meant by BOD and COD? BOD, which is also called as biological oxygen demand, is the amount of oxygen required to break down organic matter that is suspended in water by microorganisms through aerobic respiration. So if at all some organic material is present in water, and as microorganisms are present in water, they will try to derive energy by decomposing this organic matter. And for decomposition process to happen, these microorganisms will perform the aerobic respiration, that is respiration by utilizing the air, that is oxygen in particular. So with increase of the suspended organic matter present in water, the biological oxygen demand of the sample increases. That is, more waste, more demand for oxygen. That is, organisms will require more oxygen to break down those organic matter. So biological oxygen demand in a sample, if it is more, it indicates the sample is polluted. If the level of biological oxygen demand is lower, it indicates the sample is pure. And coming to the next thing, that is chemical oxygen demand. So chemical oxygen demand is the demand of oxygen or the oxygen required to break down the inorganic substance that is suspended in water by aerobic organisms. So here there may be a lot of inorganic substances, that is chemical substances that are suspended in water, and the microorganisms also derive energy by breaking them down. And with increase in the suspended chemical substances, the requirement for oxygen, that is to break the substances, also increases. So if at all you take a sample and if the chemical oxygen demand of the sample is more, it indicates the sample is polluted. The lower the chemical oxygen demand, the better the sample. So if the water quality has to be tested, its dissolved oxygen or DO should be high, its biological oxygen demand and chemical oxygen demand should be low. But when compared to the improvement of the water quality in Ganga and to that of Yamuna, it is said that Yamuna is relatively at a good condition when compared with Ganga. And the bad condition of the Ganga water can be attributed to large amounts of untreated sewage that is being dumped into the Ganges. So it is estimated that the quantity of about 3,500 million liters per day of sewage is dumped into the Ganga, of which 1,100 million liters per day is treated, and the remaining 2,400 million liters per day gets discharged untreated. So because of this, automatically what is happening? Lot of organic matter is being dumped, and along with inorganic matter also comes in. So the dissolved oxygen levels decrease, and also biological oxygen demand and chemical oxygen demand keeps on increasing. And moving on to the next topic, BRICS should help entrepreneurs, says India. So what is this BRICS? BRICS is an acronym for developing nations of Brazil, Russia, India and China, and now South Africa. So South Africa has joined the BRICS bloc in the year 2010. And these countries are believed to be the future dominant suppliers of manufactured goods, services and raw materials by 2050. And China and India will have the world's dominant suppliers of manufactured goods and services respectively, while Brazil and Russia will become similarly dominant as suppliers of raw materials. So this word BRICS has been coined by the Goldman Sachs, which has originally projected that the BRICS countries will be the fastest growing market. So recently, the members of the BRICS country had a conference, that is video conference of foreign ministers of the BRICS group, in which our external affairs minister, Mr. Jay Shankar, has said that the BRICS group should assist private entrepreneurs to help them deal with the economic fallout of COVID-19. And moving on, South Asia faces health crisis as children miss vaccination. So with the ongoing pandemic leading to global lockdown, what has happened is a lot of children are present at their homes not receiving the regular dose of immunization or vaccination. And if at all they are not receiving the regular doses of immunization or vaccination, what happens is there is a chance that all the protection that has been given to them by proper vaccination all these years, it could be wasted by the non-continuation of vaccination, by which certain diseases which have been gone or suppressed because of effective vaccination may re-emerge and be a threat to the life of many individuals on the planet. And here, if you see, the terms vaccination and immunization do not quite mean the same thing. Vaccination is the term used for getting a vaccine, that is actually getting the injection or taking an oral vaccine dose, while immunization refers to the process of getting the vaccine and becoming immune to the disease following vaccination. So in vaccination, what is happening? A component of the disease-causing pathogen, that is a protein or the entire component, is injected in live form or in dead form or in live attenuated form, means where the pathogen is alive but it is not in a condition to cause a full blown disease. It is injected to the individual through the injection or through oral drops. When that is done, that dead component of the pathogen or the live attenuated component can trigger a mild immune response, whereby which the B lymphocytes present in the body will produce memory cells along with antibodies. These memory cells will be ready and they will release large number of antibodies that in future, if at all they are exposed to the same pathogen, and this huge immune response will protect the individual from contracting the full-blown disease in the future, thereby which providing immunity to the individual. And UNICEF, that is the United Nations Children Fund, which is an United Nations agency responsible for providing humanitarian and development aid to children, which is based in New York, has said that immunization program should immediately resume at the quickest, thereby which preventing the harmful effect of these suppressed diseases. Moving on to the next thing. Brazil's top court authorizes investigation into Bolsonaro. So who is Bolsonaro? He is the Brazilian president. So why this investigation? We'll see. The Brazil Supreme Court on Monday night authorized the investigation into whether President Jair Bolsonaro committed crimes by allegedly attempting to interfere with the country's federal
police.
So what the justice has said is that the federal police have 60 days to question Mr. Moro, that is Mr. Bolsonaro's former justice minister, whose resignation last week pitched the administration into turmoil. So what Mr. Moro has said that is, Mr. Jair Bolsonaro, the president of Brazil, has many a times shared with him regarding his necessity or his need to replace the head of federal police with someone who could facilitate access to investigation and intelligence reports regarding the investigation going into allegations made by Mr. Moro, that is about the car wash corruption investigation. So what is this car wash corruption investigation? It is an investigation related to money laundering, and it is named so because it was first unmasked at a car wash in Brazil. That is about this topic. Then moving on to the next thing. Reliance Industries Limited plans rights issue to be debt free. So we have recently seen that Reliance Industries, that is for Jio Communications, has entered into a deal with Facebook and a deal of sale of 9.99% of the stake in Jio to Facebook. It has fetched Reliance Industries a significant amount, and it has used to lower the burden of debt that Reliance Industries have. And Reliance Industries have decided to become debt-free by the end of this year by issuing the rights issue. So what is rights issue? So in the yesterday's current affairs topics, we have discussed about the rights issue. So rights issue is an invitation to existing shareholders to purchase additional new shares in the company. This type of issue gives existing shareholders securities called rights. With the rights, the shareholder can purchase new shares at a discount to the market price on a stated future date. The company is giving shareholders a chance to increase their exposure to the stock at a discounted price. The rights issue is one of the way for a cash-strapped company to raise capital, often to pay down debt. Until the date at which the new shares can be purchased, shareholders may trade the rights on the market the same way that they would trade ordinary shares. So what is happening is Reliance Industries is going to give out rights issue. So this rights issue is something that is going to be given to already existing shareholders of Reliance Industries Limited. So what will happen is they are going to be given certain rights that they can, if interested, can purchase new shares from the Reliance Industries at a discounted price within a limited time span. So within that limited time span, the individuals, if interested, can purchase this furthermore shares of Reliance Industries at a discounted price, or they can trade this rights issue authority given by the Reliance Industries over the stock market, same like shares. And this is going to earn significant amount of money from the market, that is from the existing shareholders to Reliance Industries. By raising the money, Reliance Industries plan to completely do away with or close its debt, making the company debt free by the end of 2020. That is all about all the topics for today. Thank you.